Okay, so again, thank you all for joining us for this live virtual open house. We will do welcome introductions, and then we'll talk a bit about why we are creating this utility scale renewable energy ordinance. We'll talk about the schedule moving forward, where we've been, and then how we're going to move this forward. We'll do a quick tour of the virtual open house site so you can see how to use that, and then we'll have some time for questions and answers. So then with that, we'll just start with introductions. And my name is Melissa Shaw. I'm a planner here with Coconino County and have been working on this project with a diverse and very committed and very helpful advisory group. And there are a few people here today that I would like to acknowledge as having put a lot of effort into this project along with staff. And I'll just read off some names of the advisory group members who are here with us today. Terrence Cantorna, Sot Best, John Ruggles, Mary Beth Reiner. We have also Bill Auberly, Tom Kornikonitz, Lane Ashton, and Ruben Ojeda with the State Land Department. And just to remind everybody, do try to stay on mute so we can just keep the background noise to a minimum. And I'd also like to recognize planning staff with us today. We've got Bob Short, Zach Schwartz, Kelly Bingham, and Marty Hernandez. And I think I'm gonna go ahead and give it over to Kelly just to introduce some of our commissioners who are with us today.
Thank you, Melissa. Today from our Planning and Zoning Commission, we have Sot Best and John Ruggles joining us, who are also on the advisory group.
Thanks, Kelly. And again, thank you all for joining us for this open house. So we will just go ahead and go right into our discussion about why we are creating this renewable energy ordinance. We finally refer to it as the RIO. So that's kind of our shortcut terminology for this project. And really the basis for it comes from direction out of the county's comprehensive plan, which was adopted in 2015. And the plan gives us some specific direction to develop a utility scale energy ordinance to give developers clear direction on appropriate siting of utility scale projects. We've also had, if you may have been following some of the projects that have been approved, we have one operational wind farm, Perrin Wind Ranch. And then not too long ago, we approved Chevelon Wind Farm, which is, it's actually a couple of years old now that was approved, but then also a newer one, Babbitt Ranch Energy Center project. So we've had some of these projects that have been approved throughout the last several years. And so we've learned a lot, but this effort is then to actually create some standards in the zoning ordinance for siting these and guiding development of these going forward. We've also learned that Coconino County does have some potential to generate solar and wind power. So that's another part of this, another reason why we are developing this ordinance, because energy developers recognize that potential and we are responding to that. We've also seen, as I mentioned, an increase in demand for renewable energy projects, just as exhibited by the different projects that have come in to the county for approval. This project can also support forest restoration and public safety, and we'll talk a little bit about that. It's also a means to keep large landscapes and ranches intact. And you'll see when we talk about the purpose statement, how that will work. You know, you may have heard also that APS has put together a decarbonization plan. So there's room on the energy grid for renewable energy. And that is also due to the Navajo generating station being closed. So these are some of the reasons, really the main reasons why we are working on drafting this ordinance. And so more specifically, this ordinance will address wind turbines, wind power plants, solar plants, and then also biomass plants. So we got real specific in terms of what the standards will address. And just a little bit more information, these will be conditional use permits, and those are the types of permits that are heard by the Planning and Zoning Commission individually at public hearings. So there is a process to take these through the public hearing portion of the approval. I wanted to talk a little bit more about the purpose and why we are developing this. And this language is a bit edited, but it's right out of the draft ordinance. And so the purpose of the ordinance is to give county residents, leaders, staff, decision makers, and developers clear direction on how to site these projects. And it's also intended to promote reliable and clean energy sources by giving clear standards that preserve the county's intact, natural, large landscapes, such as our big ranches, and simultaneously to offer those private landholders different options for economic diversity and stability. Renewable energy can help to mitigate climate change impacts. And we also want to encourage projects that maintain and protect wildlife populations, corridors, view sheds, vegetation communities, and our dark skies. And finally, another aspect of the purpose statement is to support projects that provide clear benefits to the county. So you'll see this language in the draft ordinance. And so through working with this advisory committee, we have looked at different impacts of the projects to the county. And this is a list of some of the specific impacts that the ordinance is intended to address. It's in no order of no particular order other than it's just alphabetic. So one of the impacts that we have attempted to address with the draft is our impacts from audible noise. We're looking at how to minimize impacts to archaeological, cultural, and historic resources. Particularly for biomass plants, we're looking at emissions and air quality, particularly the particulates that may come out of those plants. We're looking at lighting in the sense that wind turbines will often have aviation warning lights on them. So the ordinance will address standards for those to the extent that can be regulated by the county. Those are required by the Federal Aviation Administration. We're also looking at ways to minimize shadow flicker from wind turbines. We're looking at ways to minimize impacts to native vegetation and also to minimize weed from disturbed landscapes. And of course, as you might be thinking, while these have visual impacts, and that is a large part of what this ordinance is intended to address, is minimizing impacts to visual resources. There is information in there about minimizing or conserving water, so not looking at projects that would use a lot of water. And then we're looking at ways to address impacts to wildlife and wildlife corridors. So I wanted to talk just a little specifically. We're not going to get into a lot of detail here, but I'll show you where you can get in, learn more detail about the specifics of the ordinance. There are three sections of our zoning ordinance that are proposed to be amended to include these standards. One would be Chapter 3, which are special uses and conditions. And that's where the standards would actually be located in our zoning ordinance. There's also Chapter 5, gives the Planning and Zoning Commission the ability to approve waivers. And that's another section that would be amended to allow waivers for audible noise, underground placement of collection lines, and also shadow flicker. So again, these are details that I'll explain later how you can learn more about. And then also we would be updating our definitions chapter, which is Chapter 6 of our zoning ordinance. So just to give you a little bit of an idea of where this changes would occur in the ordinance. And so I've mentioned to you that we have been working with an advisory group, and we've utilized other resources to help us develop this ordinance. As I mentioned, there's direction right out of our comprehensive plan. We've also have some county approved projects that we've learned a lot about. So we've drawn experience from approval of those. We've researched best practices from across the country. And then this list on the right just gives you an idea of some of the different volunteers who have provided us with a lot of great insight over the drafting process. And so the advisory group, this is just a sample of those people who have been involved in this work. And I just wanted to talk a little bit, this list mimics to some degree the list of impacts that we talked about earlier, but there have been some major issues and topics of discussion throughout this drafting process. One of those has been wind turbine setbacks and how far those should be set back from particularly residential property. We've talked a lot about impacts to vegetation and disturbance of the land and this concept of agrivoltaics, which I'm not going to get into now, but it might be an intriguing topic for you to look at a little bit more. We've looked at how to minimize grading and at the same time minimize weed proliferation. We've talked a lot about fencing standards, impacts to wildlife, visual impacts, cultural impacts. And then finally, what we're talking about is in terms of cumulative impacts. So there's a lot of information in this ordinance. It's pretty detailed. But these have been some of the major issues that the advisory group and planning staff have talked about in a lot of detail. I also want to talk a bit about the schedule now. And just to kind of give you a sense of where we've been and where this is headed, we started a meeting with our advisory group back in May of 2020. They had a meeting in December of 2021. And they've had 15 meetings throughout this time. And it's just been a real dynamic and fluid process having this type of assistance with doing this project. We've also had the opportunity to visit Perrin Wind Farm. So we've actually gone out there a couple of times. And we have also visited some of the ranches. If I could just remind everybody to please mute themselves, that would be really helpful. Thank you. So we're having our open house here today. We've had work sessions along the way also with the Planning and Zoning Commission, the Board of Supervisors, and the Tri-Diversity Council. And today we're having this virtual open house, but the actual virtual house website will be open for a week. So you'll be able to go in, look at different information, watch another video, and comment directly into the draft. So moving forward, we do have some dates on our calendars for public hearings. We have a date of March 30th scheduled with the Planning and Zoning Commission as a public hearing. And then depending on if that moves forward with a recommendation to move to the Board of Supervisors, potentially with the Board of Supervisors at a public hearing on May 10th. And so the next thing I'd like to do is just give you an actual tour of the virtual open house site, and we'll see how this works, if I can get right into it. Okay, I'll need to stop sharing and go into that. Okay, I just would like to see a thumbs up from somebody that it did appear. Let me just find you again. Okay, thank you. So this is the, and you all should have a link to this. This is the virtual open house site. And you can see there's just a description about the ordinance itself, a little bit more information on what this entails. And down here is where you'll actually see a direct link to the draft of the ordinance. All you need to do is click right here and it will take you right into the draft document, and then you can go back to the open house. So you'll be able to comment right into the draft ordinance. There's some other details here that you may be interested in. We have learned throughout the process better ways of communicating with some of our Native American neighbors and tribal governments. And there's a one-page strategy that is just their suggestions for how developers can outreach to our neighbors in more effective ways. We want to recognize all the work that our advisory group has done. So if you'd like to see some of the names of people who have been on this advisory group, here is a list. And then this link has some maps here, and these maps show you actually where our current projects are and where our approved projects are and where some pending projects are. So this is something you can zoom in and take a look more closely to. And there are just two different views of this map. One has visual resources linked to it, and the other actually just shows more of the land ownership view. So these are some maps where you can actually see what we have on the ground operating and then what would be potentially operating in the future based on information we know today. Just going down a little bit further, here's our timeline for moving this forward from today, our February 9th open house. And then down here are some more links. There's a YouTube video, which is a 32-minute video that we prepared actually and used it during a Planning and Zoning Commission retreat that gives you a lot of detail about what is in the ordinance. These slides below go with that video. Some of these you just saw, but there's a lot more detail in here if you actually wanted to spend some time and learn, really take a deep dive into what is in this ordinance. So this is available to you to look at throughout the next week. And then just at the bottom is some contact information. If you have any particular questions for me, you can find that here. So I'm gonna just stop here. And if anyone has any questions on the open house, and yes, I do see a question, a link to this, I will add it right to our chat. But if anyone does have any questions on the virtual site, go ahead and either raise your hand or just unmute. There aren't a lot of people here that we would talk over each other. So go ahead and ask any questions. Okay, and there's the link. Does anybody have any questions about the virtual open house portion of it? Okay. Well, I am going to go back then to our presentation. And open it up for just questions and answers. We have an hour scheduled. The intent here was to really give you a brief overview and see if anyone has any questions, if any of our, and there is another question. No, you do not need an account. You can go directly into that link and make comments. So does anybody have any questions? Would you like any further explanation about some of the quick details that I provided?
This is Carol. Do you have a specific location that this Zoom call is referring to, or is this a general of all of your thoughts and locations for the area?
Thanks, Carol. So yeah, this ordinance change will cover all of Coconino County, the unincorporated portions of Coconino County that we have jurisdiction over. Does that answer your question?
No, I'm asking if there's a specific site that you are, I mean, I can't tell on the map that you go quickly through if there are some locations already allocated that you are in the process of analyzing.
I see, thanks for that. So going back, and I can go back to the map if that would be helpful. There is a current project that's been on the ground for over 10 years. That's Perrin Wind Farm. And that is on the map. I can go back to that. And then there are some projects that are approved but not yet constructed. And then the map also shows projects that we have approved that are called Met Towers or Meteorologic Towers. And those sites are also located on the map because those are actually being tested for potential wind generation right now.
And you have that map available to point out a couple of them and blow it up so we can see it? Because I can't, it's hard to see when you...
Okay, yeah, I understand. Let me go back into the open house site and I can make that bigger. Okay. So if you go down here to the maps, and when I zoom in, can you see that?
There's nothing on your screen. All that's on your screen.
Oh, you know why? Because there we go. Now I'm sharing. Sorry. Okay. Did that appear now?
Yeah, I see it now. Okay.
All right. So here's the map that is on the site. And you can zoom in pretty clearly. And it will show you. I'm going to just pull this over here. Here's Flagstaff. And then here's 40, 64. This over here in dark blue is Perrin Wind Farm, and that is operational. Here is 180, and I can zoom in a bit more. And you can see these points up here. This is a recently approved project. It's not constructed.
How many acres is that?
That is, I don't have that on the top of my head. It's about 10,000 acres. I believe there are 63 wind turbines.
Is that the one that was recently publicized in the last few months of that potential one being out there? I was wondering where it was because I got the announcement that it was going to be there in northwest of Belmont.
That may be the one that you are thinking about. This is on Babbitt Ranches. The Babbitt Ranch Energy Center is what that acronym stands for. Mm-hmm. And then these others, and you can see here's 2CN up here. This one, I just want to mention that the coloring here, there are only a few towers out here. So, and these are just meteorologic test towers. They are not actually producing energy. So we are updating this map. This is still a draft. As we get more of this point data in, this will continue to be refined. And then I can move over and go down here. You'll see Chevelon Butte Wind Farm. This project is approved. It is not constructed. And then here in the legend, it does explain to you what is operational, what is approved, what is proposed. Mm-hmm. Does that answer your question, Carol?
Pretty much. And I'm hoping that I can even make it larger when I get in there. Okay, thanks for that.
Yeah, it's a good resolution. You can make it quite large.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Did anybody else have any other questions? So I'll just go down here to the schedule again. And we are recording this session, so we'll put it on this site as well. Again, we'll have it open for a week until through the 16th, which is next Wednesday. And then we will consolidate comments that we get. We will ask the advisory group to get together again and look at those comments. And then the Planning and Zoning Commission will hear this tentatively. We have a schedule for March 30th. It should be on their study session agenda for this month on February 23rd. So again, we've been working on this since May of 2020. It's gone through many drafting changes throughout time. And there is a lot of detail in the ordinance. That's why today I gave a pretty high level overview, but there is a lot more information here, particularly down here, to really get into the details of the ordinance.
Melissa, this is Zach. And for everyone, I'm on the planning staff. I wonder if it might be helpful for everybody if you're able to show how comments are made in the one module that you went up a little bit earlier.
Yeah, definitely. Thanks for that, Zach.
Thank you.
So if you go back here, the draft utility scale renewable energy ordinance, you click on the red button. And I want to make sure, did the other screen display? Did it bring you into the doc? Do you see the document?
We're seeing the document.
Okay. So all you do here, and this is the entire draft ordinance here, and you can see the plus. If you need had a comment right there, you simply you click where you want to make a comment, fill it out, and then add comment. So you can read throughout here, scroll down. Again, you just click where you want to make the comment, fill out your comment, and then add the comment. I'm not going to add it now, but this is how the site works.
And Melissa, to clarify, so can people view other people's comments?
Yes, you should be able to see other people's comments and respond to those as well. And so the first section is the actual draft standards in chapter 3. And then the next section are the few changes to chapter 5. And then the definitions. And so that's the length of the document there. And if you want to go back to the open house, you can just click on that top button.
Melissa, is this strictly a Coconino venture, or is it state and or federal as well?
So this is strictly for Coconino County's zoning ordinance.
Okay.
We have been working, you know, with state lands to get comments from them on what might be appropriate for this to address, because that does bring up a question. You know, some of these projects may be located on state lands, and then, you know, federal requirements for these facilities will also require that developers respond with certain studies and other permitting. But this is strictly a Coconino County zoning ordinance.
Are there any cost estimates for these in there, and also revenues that will be generated, and who pays them?
When you ask about costs, you mean the permitting costs?
Not really. The construction cost, the project cost.
Boy, I can't speak to that in terms of what the costs of constructing the projects are. You know, we do anticipate some revenue through the assessor's office for these projects. I don't have details on what that would be, though.
So would this be on leased land?
Some of it's on private land. Actually, quite a bit of this is on private ranch land. And then some of it is on leased land. So it's a combination.
Where would the county get revenues on it then?
If it's on the private land, on ranch land.
I see.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, because the assessor will look at the use then differently once they're constructed.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, good question. Thank you.
Do you have a general idea of the time that you think that this could, how long it's going to take to get to an actual construction on them?
Well, so again, we have some projects operational, and once construction begins, I don't know exactly how long it takes to complete a project. The Chevelon Butte project was approved a couple of years ago, and my understanding is they're going to start construction soon. That was on hold for a bit while they had their energy power agreement revised. So the conditional use permits are usually approved for a certain amount of time and then can be renewed if a developer needs to renew those. So I think that the construction process is pretty fast. If any of the other experts who are on the call would like to answer that question, please chime in.
Hi, Melissa, it's Jay. So the Chevelon project, they're gonna likely have their grading permits sometime in March, with the initial towers not being constructed until late fall. And it'll probably take them, well, we don't know how long it's going to take them to erect all the towers. So that's the schedule for Chevelon.
Thanks, Jay.
Thank you.
So these projects are, you know, definitely interesting. I know that they're something that we're seeing across the country, and this is county's response to writing standards for how these would be cited. In the ordinance, you'll see that there's a lot of detail in terms of visual resources and simulations that we would want to see with the application. So the ordinance does provide a lot of detail about what the application needs to show us as these projects come in. But just to kind of mention that these are currently being permitted as conditional use permits as a type of land use that's called utility facility. So that won't change. What this will do though is add standards that are actually codified so that they'll be in the code, and we'll give our decision makers information about how to look at these and how to analyze and review them when they come up for approval. So yeah, that's the extent pretty much of this open house. I will keep this open for the rest of the hour, just in case other people decide to join in, and we can talk about the virtual side of this. And we certainly wanted to make it as widespread as we could in terms of getting notice out about the work. There'll be additional public noticing when this comes up for public hearings, but this is our first attempt to go out to our public and introduce this to the community. So please spread the word. Don't share the link, share the information with other people who you know and think might be interested in learning about this project.
Hey, Melissa, it's Greg. I have a quick question for you.
Hey, Greg.
Hey, is there any word on the biomass? I don't see anything on the map for the biomass fuel.
We don't have any projects right now, Greg. We don't have any that we've either had a pre-application for, or that we have nothing that's operational that we know about. So that's something though, that when we drafted this, that was a potential land use that we wanted to be prepared for. Whether or not we actually see any biomass plants, I don't know.
Okay, thank you. I have quite a bit of experience with the wind generator next to our land in Kansas. It's been had wind generators up for 15 years now next to our farming and ranching land. So they've been good stewards so far.
Okay, well then it would be, if you have time to look through the draft, that would be really helpful. And then obviously you can get back in touch with me or the rest of our staff if you've got questions or comments. Thank you.
You bet.
Did anybody else have any questions or comments or ideas to make this more informative for people? We're happy to make adjustments as we need to go.
Melissa, this is Cy Best. I just want to tell everybody what a great job Melissa has done over the last 2 years. It's been a very thorough process with a lot of input, and I've been very impressed by the process part of it. And I think we have a pretty good product. So thank you to Melissa and the rest of county staff. It's really a great example of local retail politics and functionality working, I think, very well. So thanks to you all.
Well, thanks, Sot. And I do want to recognize Sot Best and John Ruggles. They wear two hats. They are on the Planning and Zoning Commission, but they've also been very involved on this advisory group process. So we thank them all for their efforts. And the sites are really interesting to tour. I did want to just show at the bottom of this page, we have a few photos here from Perrin Wind Farm and the substation. So the, and this is one you may be familiar with, the APS facility on Highway 89. If you want to drive by that and take a look at it. Just to get us, you know, a close-up view of solar panels. And then the you know, the wind farms are really not visible unless you really stop and get out some binoculars. So at least the Perrin Wind Farm is not visible. So, you know, the other ones, as they come online, will have some potential visual impact, but you know, we've looked at that and the commission has looked at those, and that's part of the decision process. We have a lot more photos to share if anybody wants to see. I know not everybody can get out to these sites, but we can certainly share more photos. So we're looking forward to all of your comments. Again, share this link far and wide, and please, you know, go, feel free to go in and spend as much time as you need to with this. Feel free to reach out to any of us if you have questions. And I'm going to go ahead and stop recording, and we will